Hi everyone, I want to thank the organizer for this very nice opportunity to present my work. Thank you very much. And as has been said, I encourage people to ask questions also during the talk if they have some anything urgent. So I will speak today about the concepts of universal dynamics in microbial ecosystem. But first, before I get into this topic, I want to present why this is how this is related to the big topic of data science or big data, and within the variety of topics related to data science, we can define some maybe a class of problems, of topics that are, in my point of view, are more related to physics, and I tell you why. Those topics relate to problems where the data recorded is related to some underlying dynamics. To be more specific, in this class of problem, we have complex systems. Complex systems, we usually mean systems that are composed of many components that interact with each other. And the data that we can record, this is what we call the system state. This is the activity of those different elements. I present it in a general way. Later on, we will speak specifically about the problem of microbial ecosystems. But in general, we have a system composed of many elements, and we can record their activity. And we can record the system state in different states. Now, the special thing about this class of problem that I want to talk about, that we believe that the activity of the element is determined by some underlying dynamics, usually can be graphically represented as a network. The network here means that the activity of each element, of each component, is affected by interactions with other elements. So the whole dynamics can be summarized graphically as a network. And as a general statement, behind any complex system, there is an underlying network of interactions. And the special thing in this class of problems that we are very interested in understanding the network. Because if we know the network, we may control the system, we can have a better understanding of the system. But the network is usually not available to us. The only available is the recorded data of the elements. So this gap that we have, that we only record the activity of the elements, but actually we are interested in the underlying network, this is something very interesting, and this is the big challenge in those type of systems. Now, specifically, I would like to focus on the system of the microbial ecosystems, and specifically the human microbiome. The human microbiome is the ecological community of microbial species that live in and on our body in different body sites. We have them over our skin, in our mouth, in the airway, but then the majority of them live in our gut. Regarding the number of microbes, it is estimated that the same number of human cells in our body, and they are classified into different species. Now, the number of different species depends on what resolution you count them. This is in ecology, you can count them in the different in different definitions. You can count the number of genera, the number of species, but it, so generally, as a rough approximation, we are talking in the gut about several hundreds of different microbial systems. And but the composition, as we will see later on, is very personalized. I will speak about it later on. The general challenge in these topics is how much can we test, can we apply mathematical rules, precise mathematical rules for those microbial ecosystems? How much they follow some rules that we can understand and we can define and we can study? And everybody said this is not an easy question. As a very brief introduction to what is the kind of data that we are talking about. So regarding the gut microbiome, the measurement of the microbial communities start with a stool sample, and then followed by high throughput DNA sequencing. And at the end, we have the abundance profile. So we are mostly interested at the bottom line, the abundance profile. This means that for each individual, for each subject, we can have a list of all the species that are present in his gut, and what is their abundance. So in this simplified color bar, we can this simplified color bar represent four different species: the blue, the orange, the yellow, the purple, and their different abundances. It is important to note that we only using this approach, we can only know the relative abundance. So we can say that like the blue species is present in about 50% of the population, and so on. Now this information is available for each individual subject. What kind of data is available to us in general? So we have in general two types of data sets. One is called cross-sectional data, and one is the time series data. Cross-sectional data, it means that we have one sample from each subject, but we have it from many subjects. In common large data sets, we expect to have between, let's say, about 100, 200 individuals, and for each one of them, we have their abundance profile. Other type of data that is much more hard to find is the time series data. Time series data, that means that the same subject is measured daily. So here in this, in the data plotted on the right, each vertical bar represents a daily sample from the same subject, and we have it over time or over some period of time. Now this kind of data is much more rare. We have only few data sets of this kind, and later on I will show you two of them, and you will understand also why. Okay, so any questions regarding just the data and what are we talking about up to now?
Up to now, there is not any question. So
good.
I assume it's everything is clear.
Okay, so let's move on. why we care about the microbiome? Because there are many reasons. The microbiome is very, in general, is very important to our health and well-being. Those microbial communities, they protect us from invasion of pathogens. They train our immune system, and they found to be related to many health functions. And unbalanced microbial communities are found to be associated with many diseases. In some cases, even the abundance of single bacterial species can be related to some phenotype. For example, maybe this in this cartoon, maybe the green species is related to some phenotype, and in if we have a high abundance of this green species, so you feel good regarding any specific phenotype. And our main motivation in these studies, from my point of view, is ultimately to be able to control the microbiome. If I have some unbalanced microbiome, whatever this means, we will talk about it. And I want to change my microbiome. So what I have to do? I have to take probiotics. I have to change my diet. What can be done to change my microbiome if I want to have some healthy microbiome? I want to change my microbial community. What do I have to do? In order to do this, we need to understand the rules that underlie those microbial communities. So this is definitely our main motivation in all these studies. Okay, some basic observations that we have from large studies of the microbiome. I will mention here three insights that I found as a physicist that they are very, very interesting and maybe not so not so trivial. So first is that our microbiome is highly personalized. I think highly personalized in two features. First, the collection of species, the assemblage of species is very personalized. That means that we do not share the same set of species. Each one of us has a very very unique set of species. And when I talk about the set of species or the assemblage of species, I mean the presence absence profile, which species are present in my gut. So this list is highly unique. But not only the set of present species, but also their abundance is very different, as suggested by this this figure. Each vertical bar represent different species, and those colors represent their relative abundance of those species. And as we can, and all those species, all those subjects are all young and healthy. And but we have a large variability in their abundance profile. So this actually raises also a general question. I mean, if the microbiome is so important for our health, maybe we would expect to have some healthy microbiome. So now the data suggests that if there is this kind of concept of healthy microbiome is very flexible. I mean, there is a large subject to subject variability. So this is one very general observation. other observation is that if we now focus on time series data of two subjects, we have here subject A and subject B, and these may be the two longest, I think, the two longest available time series data of the microbiome. And each vertical bar represents a daily sample from the same subject. So here we have almost 1 year from subject A, and also more than half a year from subject B. And as can be seen from this data, the microbiome is very, very, very stable. Very, very stable. So there are those daily fluctuations, but if you just take if I just show you one random sample, you can easily tell me if this is related to subject A or subject B. So those daily fluctuations are much smaller compared to the inter-subject variability. So in general, we can see here that the microbiome is very stable in time scales of months, and some studies suggest that even years. So this is a completely non-trivial regarding the if you consider the high complexity of this system, and immediately we can think about what makes those systems so stable. It's very, as I said, non-trivial. Now, if we look a little bit closer to those time series, we can see that in both subjects, there are some special events here in subject A around the day 100. We see those green species that appear. And also in subject B, there is another special period, a few days where the microbiome is considerably different. And it turns out that those exceptions, they relate to some special events, specific events that happen to those subjects, some very strong perturbations. In one case, it was that the subject traveled from the US to India and probably changed his diet or were exposed to different set of species. And interestingly, when this guy came back to the US, his microbiome was shifted back to the same state it was before. Now, in the other case, the subject had diarrhea, and he also took antibiotics, and this definitely changed his microbiome. But after he recovered from this diarrhea, his microbiome was shifted to another steady state, and stay stable until the end of the measurement period, as can be seen also in this presentation. This is just a PCA presentation of the same data shown above, and each point represents the daily sample. The blue points represent the period before the perturbation, the red during the perturbation, and the green after the perturbation. And as we can see, subject A, during the perturbation, this is the time he traveled to some other state, to India. His microbiome was shifted to some other state, but after he came back to the S, he was shifted again to the same steady state, as can be graphically seen here. But for subject B, after the perturbation shown in red, he was shifted to some new steady state. So if you summarize this, that means that the microbiome is very interesting. Each one of us has a unique microbiome, And those microbiome are very stable. Something keep them stable, but after perturbation, it can be shifted back to exactly the same state or to other steady state. And another example is those two subjects that were treated by FMT. I will not speak too much about this because the next speaker will expand on it. But what we can see that the state of the microbiome was shifted 2 days immediately after the FMT. FMT is a fecal microbiome transplant treatment, and this is a big perturbation to the microbiome. But after the few days, just few days after the perturbation, the microbiome stabilized in some new steady state. And so all these data sets suggest that the microbiome is highly personalized, very stable, and also alterable. Now, we as a physicist, we all those features, we immediately think about them as we can think about it as some complex system in a steady state that can be shifted. After small perturbation, the system stay near the same steady state. But if the perturbation is large enough, the system can be shifted to some other steady state. So we can definitely start to think about the microbiome as a complex system.
So sorry to interrupt. So there is a question which I think is related to the point. So the question is the following: is there a relatively stable input flow of microbiome species to the human body, for example, through diet? So I guess he's asking what is the role of migration.
Yeah. So the short answer is that extreme diet clearly affect our microbiome. That means if I start to eat only meat for 1 week, it will definitely affect my microbiome. But small perturbations, it's hard to see how those small diet change affect the microbiome. So this is the very short answer for this. Okay, so let's move on. As we said the abundance of the microbiome, what control what determine the abundance of the microbiome? So we think about interactions with the host, with the gut environment, and also with other species. Those interactions can be graphically represented as a network of interaction. Now, this network of interaction, this is also kind of this is definitely a big simplification of the reality. The reality is very, very complex. The interaction, the species-species interactions can be very complex, and also the host species interaction can be very complicated through some mediating component and so on. But nevertheless, we can think about a simplified picture of this dynamics. In this picture, we say that the green links represent a positive interaction. That means if we have more from a higher abundance from one species, this encourage the growth of the other species, and red arrows, red links represent the opposite. All this all those interactions together, and I remind you again that we are talking about a network with, let's say, hundreds of different microbial species, all this very complex network at the end determine what's going to be the steady state of the system. Now, we said before that we know that our microbiome is very different. We have different species in different abundances. Now, the question that immediately can be raised, is, do we have the ecological network? Do we have can we speak about one network, one unique network that we need to find? Or maybe each one of us has a different network, a different ecological network. Now, why should we have different ecological network? After all, let's say that the species are the same species. How can we have this different network? So the reason that those networks are just the outcome, as I said before, those networks are just the outcome of very complex biochemical interactions that are definitely affected by very specific factors, such as genetics or a specific immune system. Maybe diet, as was also raised before, and lifestyle. All those specific factors and others may lead to very different ecological, very different and very personalized ecological networks. I would like to skip those slides to get right into the point. So the point that we actually ask here, do we have, what do we think best represents the reality? The case of individual ecological networks, individual dynamics, or maybe we can speak about some universal dynamics, universal network, one network for all of us. I mean, let's say for all healthy, or the majority of the healthy population. How can it be that we have, I mean, is it reasonable that we have one network, but still we have such different microbiome? So the answer is yes, because as we know from complex systems, that complex system, in complex system, we have this concept of multi-stability. So definitely we can, in such complex systems with hundreds of species and potentially many thousands of interactions, the concept of multi-stability can be very relevant. Why do we care if we have a universal dynamics or individual dynamics? So, as I said before, if we want to be able to suggest some treatment to control the microbiome, we need to understand the rules. Now, if we have the same, if all of us or most of us have more or less the same universal dynamics, then we can try to infer this network and to understand it and to design some treatments. However, if each one of us has very different dynamics with very different interactions, that means that one treatment that was very beneficial to my friend may be very bad for me, because I have different rules. So this is very, very fundamental question. But when we search the literature, we can find some opposite opinions about it. Some studies really believe, or seems that they believe in one network for all, and they try to infer this network But other studies try to infer it individually, and here they try to infer for two subjects, and they present completely different networks. If you the size of those nodes represent their abundance, but the arrows, if you look closely, you find that they are very, very different. So it is very unclear, even in the literature, what should we expect. So that was.
Can I ask a question? So how do these methods work? In the sense that you often have more species than samples, so you cannot infer all the pairwise interaction between species just looking at. You don't have enough data to infer reliably these networks.
This is exactly the challenge. Yeah, exactly. So ideally, if we have enough data, we would be happy. I mean, this would be the ideal approach. The straightforward approach was to infer the network for each individual and then to compare the results to see if they are similar or not. But unfortunately, as you say, we do not have enough data to do this. So then we have to find some other approach to address this question. And the approach that we suggested, we called it DOC, this is dissimilarity overlap analysis. This means, very briefly, that we compare, we take set of samples, and we compare all possible pairs. Each time we take two individuals and compare their microbiome. And when we compare the microbiome, we do it regarding those two different features. First, we measure their overlap. The overlap, the mean, how much their set of species is similar. If they have exactly the same set of species, their overlap is one. If they have no overlapping species, their overlap is zero, and anything in between. And this is on the y-axis, and on the x-axis. On the y-axis, we measure the dissimilarity. The dissimilarity is there are many types of the dissimilarity measure, but it doesn't matter. You can choose any one of them, and you measure how much their abundance profile is similar. And we have a prediction. Our prediction is that if the reality, if the dynamics are completely individualized, they are completely independent, then this red line, the red line is the line that represents the cloud of points. This cloud of points is each point here represents the comparison between two individuals. Now, when we do it for the cohort of samples from a group of individuals, group of subjects, then we have a cloud of points, and the red line is maybe the general trend of this cloud. And our prediction is that if the dynamics are completely individualized, then this red curve, we call it DOC, dissimilarity overlap curve, should be flat. Why? This means that even if the overlap, if we have two samples with very high overlap, that means they have exactly the same set of species, their abundance, the profile will not be more similar, because anyway their dynamics are not the same. However, in the case of universal dynamics, we have the expectation of this pattern of negative slope. This negative slope in the range of high overlap, that means that the more the set of species are the same, I mean, the higher the overlap is, then the similarity becomes lower. That means that if the dissimilarity becomes lower, that means that the abundance profile becomes more and more similar. And this is like a footstep of of a universal dynamics. Let me see our time. I will skip those details. These are the details of the mathematical definition of the overlap and of the dissimilarity. We chose the RJFD, but it can be done for any other dissimilarity measure. The main important, I will not demonstrate it too much, but the main important point here is that dissimilarity is defined only over the shared species, and when you do this, the dissimilarity and the overlap measure become mathematically independent. So that means that you can change any one of them independently. However, if we do see some kind of relation between them, this can suggest some biological relation between those features. And when we apply this approach for real data from the Human Microbiome Project, shown here on the left with the blue curve. So here we applied it from a real data of healthy individuals, 190 healthy individuals. The guts, we analyzed their gut samples, and we see a very, very, very clear pattern of negative slope in the range of I overlap. And this is in marked contrast if we analyze the same data but after randomized their abundance, after we randomized their abundance, we effectively removed any kind of interaction between them. And in this case, this curve is indeed flat. However, in the case of when we analyze the real samples, we see very clearly this pattern of negative slope. And this suggests that that in our gut microbiome, our gut microbiome largely determined by a universal underlying network of interaction. So this is really, really good news for us when we want to develop some control strategy. When we apply the same approach to other body sites, so we find also this kind of negative slope also in our mouth cavity. However, in our over our skin, we do not see it. We see those flat blue curves. That means that our skin microbial communities are mainly determined by non-universal dynamics, probably by external perturbation. Finally, we apply this data over 17. Subjects that have a CDI infection. This is gut infection, and when we apply there, we apply our method on our data while they are have the disease. So we have this flat. So they don't have this universal ecology. Apparently, in addition to their disease state, they also were administered by antibiotics, so their gut was completely messed. However, they were treated by fecal microbial transplant, and they recovered after about 4 days. And we analyzed the data of the same subjects after they are recovered, and we find this pattern, a very clear pattern of negative slope. That means that this suggests that not only they are recovered clinically, they feel better, but also their microbiome start to follow like the normal ecological rules, the normal dynamics. So to summarize, we had this concept of universal dynamics. We find it mainly in our gut and in mouth cavity, but not over our skin. And we find this, that this universality is lost in a CDI subject, but recovered after FMT treatment. So thank you very much for listening. And if there is any time for questions, so.
Thank you very much. I'll applause for everyone. So we have time for, a couple of questions. So please write them in the Q&A section or in the chat. So in the meanwhile, I have a question myself, so I'll take the chance to ask it while we're waiting for others. So you find that in diseased patient and in communities that are strongly perturbed, like in the skin, you don't have this relation. So does that mean that, the interpretation is that, for instance, if you have a disease, you don't have these universal dynamics, if I understand correctly. So you can have a dynamics which is different in many different ways. You can be diseased in many different ways. So that is suggesting that then having a disease or having health problems is not being in a different, being on a different attractor, but is really a shift in the overall dynamics. Is that the claim?
Yeah, so actually, as I said, so in this specific case of the CDI, the situation is that they are perturbed, the microbiome is affected not only by the disease, but also by the antibiotic treatment that they have been administered. And so we do not know generally, and this is the challenge for us to understand in what disease the dynamics is different, or just from other reasons the microbiome does not follow this universal dynamics. I would say that in this case of the CDI, we may think about something encouraging, that after treatment, after the FMT treatment, so where the problem is solved, and it turns out that their dynamics, that the microbiome is pretty normal. Now, this situation might not be applicable to other chronic diseases. In some other chronic diseases, it might be the case that the dynamics is indeed individualized, and then the treatment should be also more individualized. So this is a big challenge indeed.
I see. Yes. Thank you very much. So there is actually a question in the chat. So the question is it reasonable to think that of individual microbiomes as a piece of land or a forest? Some are good for growing grapes and some are for rice. And then the other question is, there are dominant species. So I guess the question is, is it reasonable to think if individual microbiome is a piece of land or a forest? Where different people are good for different bacteria to grow.
Yeah. So I would say that it is reasonable. The it is related to some kind of big debate in the community regarding the concept of entotypes. I think that this entotype concept means that some healthy individuals can be classified to some small number of entotypes, maybe three different microbiome states that healthy people tend to cluster around, and part of the of this debate related to if there are those kind of entotypes, and those kind of clusters, and if there are exist, what's the reason? So one reason could be multi-stability, multiple steady states of the same dynamics. However, it could be, as suggested in the question, that those different people have some different ecological conditions, as suggested, like different parts of the forest, land or forest. So I would say that it is reasonable, but the answer is not yet clear. There are a lot to study here.
Great. There is, let's say we have time for one last question. So the question is, if you plot microbiome of patients of different disease on the dissimilarity overlap plot, do you think patients of the same disease would cluster together?
Yeah, I just have to say that the question is very good, but the answer is that I don't know that and this is very interesting direction that we are working on it to go this to take this tool of the DOC and try to compare different diseases. And also I would just add to the question that it is also challenging to see how much disease microbiome is clustered or can be grouped according to our approach with the healthy microbiome. And this would suggest, I mean, someone can have some gut disease or some other disease that related or associated with the microbiome, but not necessarily with non-universal dynamics. So this approach of trying to compare between disease subjects and healthy subjects, or to compare different diseases, is really one of the challenges that we are working on it right now, and this is still in progress.
Okay, so I think we are our time is due. So thank you very much for the talk and for answering all these interesting questions. So.